Should I mention the closed session first? I got my copy of the agenda. Okay. We did meet in closed session just earlier. It was informational only, and no decisions were made. So, and then a public comment. I don't know if we have any members of the public here, but this is the time that members of the public can comment on any item that does not appear on the agenda. I don't see anybody or hear anybody interested in doing that. Okay, so I'll just go on to my comments, which are going to be brief. I do want to just first acknowledge, of course, that Measure F passed, and it passed, you know, with a nearly 80%, which I just think we're all extremely happy about. And I want to thank not just the committee, volunteers, but our whole community, the work that when I went out, leafleting, et cetera, the positive feedback that I got from the community members was really, really gratifying. And I think the community stepped up, and it's got to feel good to all of us. There'll be a little more in this later. I think our last agenda item is a resolution that the board is actually going to vote on, and I'll give a couple more specifics, but that's what I've got. So are we going to put the agenda up, Jenny? First is the consent calendar. So just back up to the consent calendar, if you would. There you go. I think if we've all had a chance to read those, I can entertain a motion to approve the consent calendar.
So moved by Bill.
Do we have a second?
Second by Susan.
Do we have any comments or questions on any of those items on the consent calendar? I had one question on the medical staff credentialing, and I was just wondering, you know, there was one physician that we looked at, and it talked about the required activity for clinical appointment. Do we know what that is?
I can speak to that if you're curious. Are you wanting to know what the exact is for that? This refers to somebody who meets all requirements for privileging, but has been practicing mainly is in an outpatient setting for the last two years with some urgent care experience, but was applying for inpatient hospitalist privileges. Okay. Our requirements are very specific about within the last 2 years, the number of inpatient cases you needed to manage. So although they were only, I think, 1 year out from doing inpatient medicine to meet this requirement, we needed to make up that gap. So the extra proctoring that was outlined was making up that gap of actively practicing internal medicine physician, but making up an inpatient extra proctoring since she didn't have clinical activity that was similar during the last 2 years.
Right, that explains that. And the proctoring certainly looked very, very thorough. That's the only question I had about our consent calendar.
Thank you.
All right, so then we'll just move on. Sabrina, you've got the floor, huh?
All right, thank you. Good evening, Ken. I'm gonna give a brief update on our electronic health record project. As I introduced to you last time, we really for several months now, but officially kicked off in June, a project to discuss, first off, what would be the ideal next EHR, and then look at specific products and vendors to meet that. We started with trying to understand what our goals were, and it was very clear that the number one goal of this project was interoperability, meaning the ability for our electronic health record to communicate with that of other hospitals as well as other practices. So we're looking at both inpatient and outpatient. As many are familiar with, originally electronic health records were this great idea, and I think a lot of people thought they automatically talked to each other. I get that all the time. Patients come to me, they think, well, you have it, I sent it to you, and then it just automatically pops up on my screen and somehow integrates. I wish that was true, but unfortunately, it's very, very far from the truth that there's any integration between most electronic health records. So there were a lot of incentives for people to get an electronic health record, but originally none of those included the need for those to talk to any other vendors. And so vendors locked them down because there was competition. That created barriers for patient care. So we've since then had more legislation that is around trying to make different EHRs talk to each other. That is still kind of light years away from being reality in most instances, but there is one product that has the majority market share, especially in our area, and achieves that, and that is Epic. Epic is really the stronghold in Northern California, as well as about 50% of the market nationwide. There are other great products out there, and we've explored them, and some people even like them better, but we all understand that if truly interoperability is our number one priority, then Epic is the answer for that. As many also know, Epic is quite expensive. So how, and they won't talk to smaller hospitals because it's a very complex program directly, but they have another program called Epic Community Connect, in which larger institutions can extend their, what they call their instance, their version, to smaller hospitals. And then that hospital contracts directly with the institution who owns the kind of original agreement. There's one large vendor on the West Coast that is doing this for hospitals it's not necessarily affiliated with, and that is through Providence Community Technologies. This is part of the parent Providence company of the hospitals that you may be familiar with, the Providence St. Joe's system. It's a parallel under that same umbrella, but this is specifically an IT division, Community Technologies, that is now bringing Epic to smaller hospitals, and has about 20 that are similar size to ours. Many are critical access, and over 30 on the just on the West Coast of actual instances. Some of them are not full hospitals. Very successful operation. And so looking at everything considered, we are now really focusing in on the Providence Community Technologies Epic instance. And really why we are looking at this, as I alluded to, are the three things I list here. Number one, interoperability. Number two, that Epic has the ability to increase revenue. And number three, that we think that it will also drive quality and process improvement. And I think interoperability, I've talked with a little bit, and those are through apps that they call Care Everywhere, and another one called the Patient Portal, which is my chart, and I'm gonna show you some slides on that. How is it going to increase revenue? Epic is very much built on discrete data fields. That's why we call it kind of a beast. There's a lot to it, and you have to be very precise in your charting. But all those discrete data fields make it much easier to be very precise when you're telling your story, very exact. That data can then easily be coded and extracted automatically, which increases your charge capture and thus increases your revenue. So we can expect to, you know, get more credit for the work that's being done, really. It doesn't change the work you're doing, but a lot of times a brief note is hard to fully get all of everything that was done captured accurately. So the more accurate you are in that, the better your charge capture. And hopefully the better your revenue. Doesn't change our reimbursements, that's still a cap, but we can, but it can change what we are, our level of billing. And then that same philosophy can really drive quality and process improvement, because when you have all these discrete data fields filled, you can pull those and you can analyze those. So you can have in real time, there's a lot of great systems built into this that can feed back to you how you're doing, and you can analyze everything from the amount of computer time being spent, so you can look at user satisfaction, to really narrowing down on the patient caregiving and the order sets and how they're being used and whatnot. So there's very powerful analytics through this program, and that really can help drive process improvement as well. So we can go to the next slide. I want to show you a little bit of some my chart captures. These are a couple, these are snapshots out of a couple real-time people's my chart accounts. I apologize for the dog barking. Hopefully they will start soon. What you're seeing here is how it looks on that screen if you're not familiar with my chart. This is a list of allergies, health issues, messages, visits, care team, medications, test results. Those are things that if you have different instances, meaning your doctor's at UCSF and you have a doctor at Sonoma Valley Hospital, those are easily interchangeable through my chart if we're on Providence and you and sharing with UCSF. So this is demonstrating that even across different Epic rollouts, there is communication through the patient portal, as well as on the physician side. That physician side is called Care Everywhere. The patient portal side is called MyChart. So you can link accounts, basically. You can see on the screenshot on the right side that here it talks about ones that automatically come up. In this instance, somebody had a primary organization, and then they had also seen something at Contra Costa Health Service Department. And then it'll automatically see that and say, hey, link that account. And you can do that, and then that information would import and show up in your same chart. However, just for details here, Kaiser doesn't play nice in the system, even though they are an Epic. That is something that John and I have already talked about, bridging and having that communication if and when the time is appropriate, but Kaiser does not allow access. Most other non-Kaiser organizations are on Epic do, but it is up to the owner whether or not they want to fully automatically share, or if it's a request only. If you can go to the next slide. And of note, Providence does not block anyone, is the way that you can see Kaiser does in that slide. So just if you're not familiar with this, again, to show you how easy this is, this in this instance, somebody called Andrea, this is her chart. You can see that her primary is with UCLA Health. So that would be the same if her primary account was with UCSF. This is what her original menu would show. But then she's also being seen at Cedars-Sinai. And you can see that because she's been seen at both and they're both on Epic, this is her medications profile. If you were to scroll down in this, all of her medications, no matter who they were prescribed by, would show up in this. And if she wanted to see who had ordered them to know who she should request refills through, et cetera, she would just be able to click on those tabs so she could link back to the institution. And then if you look at the third screenshot, this is looking at your appointments. So if you want to see where you have appointments, it integrates them. The first one is actually a UCLA appointment, and the second one is actually a Cedars-Sinai appointment. So it actually integrates them within one tab for you once you've linked your accounts. You can scroll down. So here's just some final examples. If you, by chance, for some reason, there's a cross between Kaiser and or another system that's non-Epic, and you need to share your health information, there's actually ability, if you are logged into your MyChart, to use what they call Share Everywhere, which is you can give one-time access to a physician that you're seeing outside of your normal network, and they would then be able to access your MyChart account and get that information for their system. So you can do that yourself, basically release your information. It also has really great things for being instantly able to see things like your vaccine records. So showing proof of vaccination is very easy across these, and those are all pulled on automatically. And if by chance, there's a lot of different ways for different systems to send you health alerts, to tell you to remember to do a mammogram, or you're due for your colonoscopy, or whatever it might they want you to do. If those, in some instances, those are immediately available to you in your primary account. If they're in an accessory system, you can click on it and it'll open it up in a separate web browser automatically. So it'll link to it where you could then further go through those like you are through a message system. So as you can see there, even if you're not on the same instance, there's quite a bit of interoperability across instances through this program to share your results and to be able to obtain them. And it's a very similar look on the clinician side program, being able to really visualize not just what is done in your facility, but what is done with anybody who has Epic. And it can be, you know, it can be national. It doesn't have to be regional. It's really anybody who is allowing sharing and has an Epic connection. So you can scroll on down. So where are we at with this? We are working with the Providence Community Technologies Growth and Expansion Team to get a precise final cost estimate. This is really getting to the nitty gritty of which module, it's a very modular system we need based on what services we provide. Then we'll talk a little bit more through the contracting phase. We'll be bringing this back to the board. Simultaneously, we're also assessing what our options are for general ledger and materials management software selections. Those currently are integrated with our Allscripts Paragon product. They are not part of Epic. Everybody uses a third party that ties in with Epic. There are several options on the table that we're exploring, looking at new vendors long-term and also temporarily maintaining that part of Paragon, depending on timing and several other factors. So we're simultaneously working through that so that we can have a cognizant long-term plan for the entire system. For the EHR portion, we still have a goal of going actually live with the implementation in late 2022. So just over a year from now. So we've got a very busy year coming up, and I will be coming back to you, I'm sure, every board meeting for the next few as we progress through this to give you updates and talk through the finances once we have those specific numbers. So any questions about the EHR project before I move on to my other updates?
Yes, Sabrina, I'd just like to ask you about our physician community, of which many have various EHRs in their office. Is there any way they can upload that information to Epic or vice versa?
Just so I understand, are you saying if they're not on any Epic instance, is there any way they can get Epic information into their own EHR?
Or vice versa. Yeah, the Epic, obviously, for the community members is much too expensive. But when I was in practice, it was funded by Sutter. We couldn't afford it. But so the question is, how do we integrate the physician's practice EHR with the MyChart?
Right. So that depends on the physician office is the answer. Many of ours, those that are members of the Premium and Health Medical Network, they are on Epic. We actually do have some private practices that are also on Epic. So if they're already on a sponsored instance, that will be very easy. If they're not and they're truly private practice with a web-based EHR or something else, then it comes down to, it depends on that EHR's specific capabilities. But at minimum, if it's an electronic health record at this day and age, they consider what we call a CCD, which will give at least a problem list, allergies, medications, some basics. It's harder to share chart notes. They do. It's just depends on the individual system, how they're filed. And it varies incredibly depending on each different vendor. So yes, we will definitely be sharing stuff. And at minimum, those basics, so they'll get them. As far as, you know, other chart notes and stuff, it depends on what system they're running. But we'll continue to work with that and build those bridges as we're able.
Right, thanks.
So if Sonoma Hospital signs up, as we're talking here with this Epic style, our private practitioners who are out in our community now, what is it going to cost them to get on board?
So we've looked through that. It's quite expensive and probably out of the cost range for an individual practitioner. If those practitioners were to agree to band together and go for a common implementation, it would probably be doable. But a single practitioner, no matter who needs a sponsor basically to make it cost affordable for them. So it's really going to be up to what those private practitioners are willing to do and what they want, what their options are, if they want to join a larger group or if they want to integrate just to be on an Epic instance. And that could potentially be sponsored through the hospital or through UCSF. Both would have the ability to extend their resources to have a clinic implementation, because there are complete clinic implementations of Epic, but it is quite cost prohibitive to an individual practitioner. Each different site would have its own implementation cost. So it's really about condensing the sites first. So there's barriers.
That's what you were talking about, Michael, about it being really expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was very expensive. The Sutter actually supplemented the positions in the community. So we all wound up going on Epic. But believe me, the great majority of us could not afford to have done that without their help.
Yeah, I don't think any of our local practitioners could do it without a significant amount of help from somewhere. So that's really the barrier, not the technology, it's the financing, no matter who, what instance they're trying to get on. And it's a lot about individual choice, about usually having to partner up and in which way they are willing to do that.
I think that's
something. Yeah, this is Bill. Is there any considerations for the patient user or the patient about HIPAA constraints or concerns? And does the patient have to give a waiver or acknowledge the access to their data in some way? Do they check a box somewhere and say, yeah, anybody can look at it, or only certain doctors? What are there any HIPAA challenges involved?
So once you've established care with a physician, when you give that physician rights to care, do your care, that's where that consent would come from a seeking care perspective. From a MyChart perspective, it's completely in your control. Right. It's in the patient's control from a MyChart. From an otherwise, it's when you consent to care. So it's only shared, what is shared automatically or shows up is when you develop, like I can't just look up somebody who is cared for at UCSF but has never established a relationship with Sonoma Valley Hospital. I can only view a patient's UCSF records if they establish care with Sonoma Valley Hospital. So you have to be a mutual patient in order for data to be shared.
All right, thank you.
So I was just gonna say that I think that what we were just talking about before is something that we need to bear in mind about what the value is gonna be to our medical community. If our private practitioners who are not already in PRIMA or something are not gonna be able to participate.
I think it still increases, Paragon is really bad at what it can do now. It can't really send CCDs, it can barely. So what Epic can produce is already leap years ahead of what Paragon can produce. Mm-hmm. So even though it may not be fully integrated as if they were on Epic, it's as close as we can get unless they choose to go on such a system.
Okay, thanks. Before you continue with the next, I neglected to have the board vote to accept the consent calendar. I got motion and second, but can I just ask everybody if they're in favor of accepting the consent calendar?
Aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
Thank you. So your report, Sabrina?
Sure. Go ahead, Jenny. All right, so moving on to the CMO report. I always start off with COVID, at least for the last year and a half. On the hospital side, COVID was very stable to very low, 0 to 1 in patients at most times for the month of October. What we're seeing in the community is a bit of a plateau with slight increases in Sonoma County and some other areas over the last couple of weeks. No one's quite sure which direction we're going for sure at this point, but we're definitely no longer declining for the last few weeks. The big news is vaccines. We're all celebrating that as of late last night, pediatric vaccines, meaning ages 5 to 11, have an EUA approval through Pfizer. So that has been great news. It's also been booster month, and boosters were approved for nearly anyone who wants one, and that would be with all Pfizer, Moderna, and J&J. And we also had approvals for the mix and match concept, meaning that your booster doesn't necessarily have to be what your primary series was if you choose differently or if that's what's available. So we did offer mini boosters, and October was the time we did our health fairs for employees and physicians. Flu vaccine is mandatory, and those were given for all, and that's mandatory on both the hospital and the county level. Boosters are not considered necessary to be considered completely vaccinated at this time, so they're completely optional. So far, we've given out at least, I think, 115 boosters to employees, so pretty good uptick there as well. And we're continuing to offer those. We're also continuing to offer vaccines to patients who are at the hospital for another reason. So if they're an inpatient and it's applicable and they haven't had it, We continue to do that. Likewise, if they were to come to occupational health or other, the ER, et cetera, and it's appropriate to give it, we have it available for those patients. The other big thing we've been working on is the rollout of the pediatric vaccines. And we've coordinated and with the Sonoma Valley Unified School District, as well as all of the privately run schools in Sonoma and the Sonoma Valley Health Center, to bring education to the community around pediatric vaccines. We did a total of 4 webinars over the last month or so, 2 in English, 2 in Spanish, talking about the safety of the vaccines and the background and really answering questions for the community. And we will be also partnering with the health center and the county, who are now scheduled a series of vaccinations to be done in our local schools. That calendar will be published soon, but they are starting, I believe, on November 12th, and the hospital will be actively volunteering and helping staff those clinics in our schools, and those will run through the end of the year and into January. So we're really hoping and excited to get our youngest members vaccinated and really close the loop of the last really group of kids that are out there and very vulnerable. Of course, we still don't have anything for the 0 to up to 5-year-olds, but those will be coming in 2022. But those aren't our school age children for the most part. So this is a huge move forward in keeping our school age children safe and protecting them as well. So very excited about that. On the hospital side, this was the first month of having a full team of in-house case managers and social work. They have been working through getting to know each other and getting things back on track, and everything seems to be working out very well. So I'm really hoping that we continue to see some improvement in some of our quality related metrics related to having them help move patients through our system and get them the resources that they need after they leave our care. So far that's going very well. I've spoken before about some work being done in Central Sterile. Unfortunately, the hospital, as well as many organizations, are facing staffing shortages and turnover, and that has also been affecting Central Sterile. So there's been some struggles with staffing and turnover there, but the team is managing through that. We haven't had any gaps in care or incidents at this time. One thing that Mark Kobe has been assisting with is our meaningful use criteria. This is, again, some of the things I was referring to around interoperability, making one EHR talk to the other. As I said, Paragon is not the best at this, so it takes jumping through a lot of hoops to send one and to have somebody receive it on the other end. So he's been working with several partners to successfully get those sent upon discharge, those care summaries, in an electronic format. We've been sending them, but we've mainly been relying on faxes. And so we're trying to send them directly from what's populated in the EHR to the primary cares. Some are not even on electronic health records, so it is not possible in all instances. And the health center is on electronic health record, but it cannot receive any sort of CCD at this time. They are upgrading and trying to get there, but so that for that reason, we don't have 100% compliance, but we are trying 100% of the time if there's a receiver that can receive it. We're also now trying to pull those upon admission so that we get data from a primary care or whomever may have had an established relationship with the patient when they come to our hospital. So that has taken big leaps forward in the last few weeks. Medical staff, the one thing I do want to mention is our new surgery department chair, Dr. Alexandridis, one of our local surgeons, is kind of championing an initiative to revamp our pre-op process and make it a little bit more user-friendly for both patients and physicians. So very excited about that getting started again. And on the quality front, the biggest news is I would like to introduce to you all Kylie, who is our new director of quality. I believe she is on us. I have to change on here still. Okay, there you are. I have to change my screen to find her. But Kylie comes to us with a wealth of experience. She has over 25 years of experience as a nurse. I think about 18 or so of those in ICU, and really great knowledge. She's also been a director of quality and served as well as a CNO briefly as well before coming to us and relocating to Northern California. So she's been with us about 10 days or so now and is really off and running. So I'm very excited to have her join our team, and I'm sure you guys will be hearing a lot more from her in the future. So welcome, Kylie.
Thanks, Sabrina. Nice to meet everybody.
All right, and scroll on down. The only other thing I think to mention, well, two things is for quality, we are moving our data abstraction to a to outsourcing that to a company called QCentrics. And this is another connection and benefit we made through UCSF. So this is something by reaching out to their quality department, this is what they use. And we were able to piggyback off of their arrangement. So we're very excited to get that going. Unfortunately, there is still a little bit of a lag time for implementation. So we won't go live until the spring, but we have finished making those arrangements. And I just will also just mention that we are continuing to do a lot of work with the patient satisfaction scores, our HCAHPS and OSHCAHPS, and the team is actively working to really improve those numbers, and I'll continue to share those with the quality committee and others. And I think John will probably touch on the flood, but I just will say that no patient care was interrupted, thankfully. So that's all I've got.
Right.
Okay, thank you, Sabrina. So John, I guess you're next.
Yes. Jenny, you want to scroll down? All right. Yeah, the top of the report here you'll see, and I think you've seen, we continue to rebound. The hospital continues to be busy, primarily in the outpatient setting. We have added Kylie, as well as Terry in the last month or 6 weeks. So we're excited to have two new leaders in the organization to bring some fresh ideas to us and continue to press us to be the best we can be. As Sabrina mentioned, COVID is obviously going to be a thread that will continue with us, and we continue to position ourselves as an authority in the Valley to try to make sure that we can inform our community with truth as much as possible. Sabrina did a great job at the town halls the last week, and we continue to be challenged and to have questions asked, both informative questions and less informed questions, but we're going to continue to be present and be available to answer whatever question may come up to make sure that our community is as informed as possible. I won't read through the whole report. I will provide the update that the Diagnostic Center project continues. We've engaged an architect to do a review of the project. We are, you know, still on hold, having paused the project to separate from our prior contractor, and we're going through that process with the expectation that we will restart here shortly. The only other update, again, you'll see there at the bottom, Jenny, if you scroll down, that our vaccination rates continue to be very high. The medical staff was way ahead of the curve, and the employees have joined them, with very few folks who are using an exemption or needing an exemption to not be vaccinated. So we're very, very happy with the operational status and the fact that we continue to provide care and avoid, thanks to Dr. Kidd's leadership, any transmission within the hospital. I will leave it there and pause for any questions.
No questions.
Very good. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, John. So I guess next we have Ken, you and Sarah, huh?
Yeah, well, I'll turn it over to Sarah to give the monthly report for October.
Yep, September.
Excuse me, September. I'm already closing October.
Yeah, we're working on October.
Yeah.
So September saw similar trends as the first couple of months. You know, we had higher volumes in the ER and outpatient than we were seeing during the pandemic. We're still not up there with inpatient volumes. We're seeing lower inpatient surgeries. That could be a trend of moving to outpatient. Needs more follow-up. The payer mix for September, if Jenny, if you go to the next page. We had Medicare at 46.5% versus 55.2%. We saw Medi-Cal at 18.8% versus a 19.2%. And commercial jumped up to 28.2% versus 21.5%. And this has to do with some increased correctional facility patients that we saw in September. Our cash goal for September was a little under $4 million. And we had collected $3.6 million. So we were under goal by $375,000. And year to date, we're under goal by $752,000. So right now I'm really taking a close look at our AR to see where we're not, you know, estimating the accounts correctly. And I'm hoping by the end of the year to be sort of caught up with the goal. We have average days of cash on hand of 45.5 days versus prior month, which was 52.3. Our AR days are at 42.4, which is pretty steady with what we had last month. Accounts payable is also staying steady at 3.5 million, and the accounts payable days is 43.1 days. And I just want to touch on the balance sheet briefly. That's attachment C. You can see line 19 and line 28, the interest and loan principal has been reduced, and that primarily has to do with the bond payment that happens in August. And then moving on to Schedule D, the income statement. For September, we had a gross revenue of $23.5 million, and that was $3 million better than budget. Our deductions from revenue were a little under $20 million, which was 2.4 unfavorable to budget, and that has to do with the favorable gross patient revenue. So our net patient service revenue was better than budget by $628,000. And then after accounting for the other operating revenue, we had total operating revenue of $3.9 million, which was $616,000 better than budgeted. As we move to expenses, the expenses for September were unfavorable to budget by $335,000. And that primarily has to do with professional fees being under budget. And again, you'll hear me say this every month that it has to do with how I budgeted the UCSF management fees. I just didn't have the full picture when I did the budget. So we'll see that throughout the year. And there were also some costs for some HR legal costs related to an employee case in there as well. Supplies are over budget due to increased lab supplies for COVID testing. We're seeing an increase in those. And in purchase services, we had the payout to Banyan Medical Services to cancel the case management contract. So on line 30, you'll see that our operating margin was $775,000 versus a budget of $1 million. So that's $280,000 better than budget. And then after accounting for all the non-operating revenue and expenses, we had a net loss of $264,569 versus a budgeted loss of $16,248 with an EBITDA of a negative 5.7 versus a budgeted EBITDA of negative 14.6. And that's on the next page, Jenny. And then I just wanna look at the cash, which is the Schedule F. You'll see that we ended September with average days of cash on hand of 45.5 and month end of 47.3. You'll see that the next couple of months, our cash will dip, but then it should come back up in January after we collect the parcel tax and an IGT that should come in December or January. And if all holds true, we should end the year at about 54 days of cash.
Sarah, you might mention too, we've made the claim to the insurance company for the cyber attack. The claim itself is $1.5 million. And we expect something between 1 and 1.5. And that cash we have not accounted for, but it should come in the next 3 to 6 months.
That's correct.
questions.
Any questions for Sarah or Kim? Thank you so much.
Yeah, this is Bill. It came up during the audit committee meeting that, as you'll may perhaps see when that is reported, that there was a different percentages for the payer mix. And at least I never really paid that close attention to the title on the payer mix that's reported here monthly, which is gross charges. Mm-hmm. Whereas, as Ken, and maybe it was you, Sarah, pointed out during the audit committee meeting, that the distribution that was reported there was really on the net patient revenues in that mix. And it was raised, I suggested that perhaps we want to show that on that basis, in addition to the gross that we've been looking at, because that's really what has the impact. Mm-hmm. So I think I'll have it on the finance committee agenda to consider recommending that we show the net revenue distribution.
We actually have that on attachment A, but I think we need to bring it forward and be more visible in terms of reporting.
Right. Well, yeah, good. No, that's, I didn't know where that was. Yeah. So, because maybe I'll just put it in a position, because for years, we've kind of been thinking where it's shown as, wow, we've got this commercial is so low at only about 20 or 22%. So maybe Ken, for finance, yeah, you might recommend where we could show that better?
Yeah, well, Sarah and I have talked with it, in addition to Carl, who's on the finance committee. We hate to change reporting in the middle of the year, so we're gonna revise the report towards July 1st, so there's no confusion at the beginning of the next week.
Sure, no, I agree with that, yeah. Well, you can then, volunteer that opinion or that suggestion at the finance meeting. So we'll have that as an agenda item. But, you know, because it does look a little, you know, that's important insight that we are getting on a net revenue basis.
As you can see on attachment A, about the 1-2-3 paragraph down, commercial and government in terms of cash is 42% of the cash.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's another point, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, we'll bring that out in finance, make some of us feel better.
Okay, we're happy to make you feel better.
Thank you.
Okay, if that's it for the financials, I think, John, you're up next again.
Yes, we wanted to, actually, we're gonna table this. We're not gonna propose this tonight.
Right.
We will bring that to a future meeting.
Right. So the next one, you're still up. It doesn't get you off the hook.
Darn it.
Nice try.
Keep scrolling down. We cannot table this next one. This one's important.
No, we can't.
All right. So this is a summary that that Sarah and Ken put together with the team's help, Sabrina and others, to summarize sort of where we are from a capital perspective on the two major projects that we have coming up. And then after we've got some information on minor capital, discretionary capital that needs to be that we'll ask for approval on. But this right now is for information purposes. We have the contract that we are negotiating a settlement with Dome Construction, and you see the cost there. And then the EHR implementation below it, and the year one cost, or fiscal year 22, which would go through next June's cost, and then fiscal year 23, when the go live happens next winter. Those two big chunks together coupled with the minor capital you see highlighted in yellow in the middle of the page, put us at about 4 million in this fiscal year and 4.5 million in the next fiscal year. To counterbalance that, we've tried to summarize below some of the sources of cash that could be used to fund those expenses, or those investments rather. We believe that the EHR and the ERP implementation, mostly the EHR, frankly, will enhance our revenue. These are operating uses, I apologize. The 1.375 is an application of operating cash. The board designation, which I believe we talked about at the last board meeting, you approved a bridge, $1 million to bridge any gap between the foundation's funding of the project, the ODC project, and cash availability. That bridge is likely not necessary, as the foundation is well ahead of where we are in the project. So we don't think we're going to need that cash as a bridge. So we would propose to apply that to fund these current investments. And then we expect cash to come in from the cyber attack, as well as a new position that we are negotiating to start in January. The contract is not signed yet, but that is the plan. Those sources would total, as you see below, 3.3 million. And then on the right column in fiscal year 23, we have sources, again, of a full year of that position, as well as operating cost savings and efficiencies totaling about $1 million. So what we're looking at is a need for $4 and $4.5 million over the next two fiscal years and funding of about half of that. So we're working to figure out how the remainder of that funding is going to happen. Any questions on this presentation?
Yeah. This bill, what are you requesting for us to approve this evening in terms of the capital program, even if it's only for the next?
Yes, good question. Today, what I'm going to suggest is those three yellow lines, the capital equipment, IT equipment, and building improvements. That minor capital is needed.
Where do we see that? Let's just
to the top of the screen.
Oh, there, right, those now. Three items there.
Correct.
Planned capital, the equipment, building improvements, and then the IT.
Well, the IT line for this fiscal year is zero.
Yeah.
Oh, so okay. It's really the capital equipment and the building improvements. And the building improvements is largely roof replacements. I want to say repairs, but they're not replacement. Mm-hmm. They're not repairs there. It's a capital investment.
So it's a 592,000 odd,
537.
Is that correct?
537.
Not 537.
Yeah, it's 320,400 on the bottom, and then 272,137 on top. So we're looking at 592,537 to be approved.
Yeah, right.
Tonight.
Yeah, 592,537. Yeah, that total is shown there as that number, right?
Right.
And I think the Finance Committee actually authorized that. And maybe even the IT equipment as well, but
yes, so I believe we reviewed 700,000 worth of investments.
Right, we did. But you're asking the board.
I just want to point out that the IT dollars that were in there before were for something that was already purchased in fiscal year 2022. Right. So I took that out.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Which is
so the board is being asked to consider the 592,537.
Right.
I have a board meeting.
I don't know who that is. Well, the clarifying the number, therefore, I would move and hope for a second for that 592,537 on behalf of the Finance Committee.
Thank you.
So do I hear a second?
Second.
Great, thanks, Michael. Those in favor?
Aye.
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 Anybody opposed? This was pretty thoroughly discussed at Finance Committee, and it's actually, it's nice to see the number a little less than what we saw there.
Well, we're gonna keep working on it.
Yeah.
As Sarah notes, below the bright yellow line, there are other funding sources that were working, and we'll see where we come up with those.
Okay. So then we go down. I think, Bill, I'm gonna let you lead on this. Would you think the audit? Would you like to?
Well, we're ably assisted. I don't see all the participants. I assume that Liz Merrick is on the, as she did at the audit committee and accepted this report. The auditors had no complaints, objections, or findings in any respect. And therefore, Liz is going to give us an abbreviated report with a fewer slides, somewhat shorter comments, but especially at the audit committee to compliment, you know, Ken and Sarah in particular for the very well-worded and informational management's discussion and analysis. Very well done.
Yeah, Bill Browsey, the partner, is on, and Liz Merrick, the manager of the account, is on. And we'll turn it over to Liz or Bill, either one.
Okay, all right, great.
I can start, Liz, if you want. Yeah. Just real quick, as Bill mentioned, we'll do a high level. Liz will actually do a high level summary of the results of the audit. I know you are. On the agenda for approval of the report. So we are here to answer any questions the board may have before you have to go through that process. Appreciate the time. I know you guys have a busy agenda, so we do appreciate the time to get in front of the board. Many times we just meet with the audit committee as we did this year. We go through everything in quite a bit of detail there, and So do appreciate the opportunity. And with that, Liz, I will let you give them a real quick summary of the results.
Okay, great. We do have like a very brief PowerPoint. If we can, either we can share it or I can just speak to it. Thank you.
You can share now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, does everyone see our overview?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Okay, well, great. Thank you, everyone, for giving us a little bit of time to go over the results of the financial audit for June 30, 2021. We just have a few slides. Like Bill both mentioned, we went over the results of the audit and the audit report in detail with the audit committee, I think, at the end of October. So we just want to bring a few key things to your attention here. Just as a comment, we have a brief slide on the client service team. Bill and I are continuing on the audit engagement for a number of years now, and we have another concurring partner that does our review of the report. So a consistent team on the audit, again, for the last several years. Just to give you an idea of some of the audit highlights, some of the key takeaways from the audit. This year, as last year, we did conduct the audit remotely. I was able to come out and meet with Ken and Sarah and go over some things, but the majority of the audit was done remotely this year, hoping to be able to come back on site next year. That would be great. In our report, you see in the beginning our auditor's opinion. It's an unmodified opinion on the financial statements. So essentially that's saying that we have no limitation to our opinion, that the financial statements are fairly stated in all material respects. This year we have a unique piece to the audit due to the receipt of the provider relief funds. Actually, those were received last year, last fiscal year, at June 30, 2020, but due to just some delays on HHS and HRSA giving the instructions on when these single audit is required, we did that work this year, meaning for the June 30, 2021. So essentially, if you receive a federal grant and have expenditures in excess of $750,000, you're required to do a compliance audit. So, you know, many, many providers, hospitals and other providers that have never had to have this type of audit before were required to have it for this current year, and probably will not see that again unless there's some other unique, hopefully not, some other unique funding distribution in the future. Generally, just, you know, no difficulties encountered in performing the audit. You know, Sarah, Ken, and their team are always very easy to work with, very responsive. We were able to get through all of our audit procedures, and I guess also importantly, within the planned timeline, so that we can meet with the audit committee towards the end of October and then have the audit ready for board approval at this meeting today. We had no material weaknesses or significant deficiencies in internal control that were identified based upon our procedure. So that's always, you know, an important finding. That covers both the financial statement audit as well as the federal audit for the provider relief funds. So very good result as far as internal controls for the audit. Here's a little bit of an overview, a little bit more flavor of what we spend our time on for the financial statement audit. We're always going to look at areas of risk, meaning areas that include estimates that are determined by management or just areas that are unique, like I said, the provider relief funds. So we look at, we're always going to walk through all the key internal controls over the significant operating cycle so that we can plan our audit. The net patient receivables, we look at the collections on the receivables at different points in time, prior year end. We do a mid-year interim review of the AR balance. And then we also look at collections subsequent to year end. So this is all to ensure that the accounts receivable that's reported in the financial statements are reasonably stated, given the uniqueness of healthcare receivables, contractual allowances, and things of that sort. We spend a fair amount of time in that area. As I mentioned earlier, the provider relief funds generated or triggered the single audit for the expenditure of those funds. So we had to look at, and again, this is something where HRSA puts out very specific compliance guidelines, what we need to look at, and then test the expenditures. So essentially those provider relief funds could be used for obviously expenditures for COVID-19. And also, which is very unique to this program, is a concept of lost revenues. So if you can prove that, you know, expenditures are kind of an obvious thing, but if you can substantiate that you lost revenues in fiscal year 2020 by quarter, then they allow you to claim that as being used for, by the provider relief fund. So very unique transaction that, you know, took a fair amount of effort this year by Sarah, her team, and by us on our side for the audit. We're also gonna look at the capital asset activity. That's the fixed assets, the property and equipment, the additions for the outpatient diagnostic center. We'll do testing over that activity. All of the, you know, the debt, the bonds payable. We looked at the bond refinance in August of 2021, and that's incorporated into our audit report. The terms of the line of credit, capital leases, kind of everything in the debt arena. And then revenue recognition kind of goes hand in hand with your AR. You know, every year we'll pick a sample of patient claims and look at the underlying documentation and ultimate collection of those claims. So that's the majority. That's, you know, of course we do a lot of other things, but that's just some of the areas that are of interest, I think. Require communications. So these are actually the communications that we were required to discuss with the audit committee. And we did that in our meeting, essentially just kind of reviewing, you know, our responsibility is to issue our opinion on the financial statements, plan our audits so that we can issue the opinion in accordance with generally accepted auditing standards. That's what we do. As I mentioned before, the plan, scope, and timing really did not change. We did have a little twist with the single audit report that is close to being completed as well. But we were able to keep to the timeline substantially this year. So in the audit report, or the report that we you have in a draft form, all of the significant accounting policies, that's what management's using to create the financial statements. Those are all listed in note two. There was really nothing new, no new accounting policies in the current year that had to be addressed. So those are recurring. And then again, it's important to understand where the significant accounting estimates are in the financial statements. As always, going to be accounts receivable, the contractual allowance, reserve, as well as the bad debt allowance for the self-pay patient accounts receivable. That's a significant estimate. The assigned lives of the capital assets or the fixed assets. And then there's an accrual for a workers' comp liability. That's an actuarially determined liability. So that's where some of the estimates lie in the financial statements. The significant disclosures are really in our report. I think the disclosures are fairly consistent year over year, this year to prior year, in the report itself, the draft report, which you have. Again, no issues or significant disagreements while going through the audit. I think the audit process went very well, especially considering we're on our second year of doing a remote audit. So thanks to Sarah, Ken, and their team for always getting us everything we need timely. We do appreciate that. Uncorrected and corrected misstatements. Again, if we found a correction to a financial statement line item as a result of our audit procedure, we would be required to tell you about that. That might be an issue, and we had nothing of that nature come up during the audit. And again, as I mentioned in the beginning, we had no material weaknesses or significant deficiencies in internal control, or again, no material misstatements that could lead you to have these kind of findings in the audit. So overall, a very good audit result for the year, which has been consistent for the hospital over the last several years.
Just a comment too, Liz, and there's no management letter this year, so this is a sixth year in a row we have not had a management letter, which is a good thing.
Right. Yeah, so if we have a material weakness or significant deficiency in internal control, we are required to document that in a letter. Sometimes we have best practice, recommendations that don't rise to that level. We would just discuss those informally with management. But yeah, if we had something significant, we would have to document that in a letter. So there is no letter. Right, Ken?
Thank you.
All right, with that is our abbreviated presentation of the results of the audit. Are there any questions that anyone may have for us?
Okay, thank you for that presentation. We're supposed to...
Oh, excuse me, Bill, if I may make a comment. Well, let me maybe make a motion on behalf of the audit committee to approve acceptance of the audit report as presented.
I'll second that.
Thank you, that's just what I was gonna ask for.
Okay. So a couple of quick comments. I would ask the CEO, this isn't really part of the discussion, but it's probably the only place to make the comment. I guess I'd ask the CEO. I didn't have a chance to write a note, but I think in the finance, I mean, the audit committee, we were expecting with this approval that the audit report be put on some appropriate place on the website. I'm not sure where that is currently. So Bob is part of this, Bob Kinney. So if he would put the entire report so that it could be accessible to the public, and also accompany that, the original PowerPoint presentation that Lynn gave to the audit committee, that would follow the audit report itself we have here. So if there's no objection to that, that's my request. So the community can access the full report as well as the presentation, if that's agreeable to Ken and the finance staff, that be done.
Once you approve your motion, John and I will have to sign a letter that there's no significant subsequent events. And once that's done, we certainly can do that.
Oh, very good. Standpoint. Yeah, thanks. And the only other point is, I think in the meantime, Ken and I and Liz have messaged back and forth. And this was actually something that came up with the audit committee also, that the audit committee will have another meeting at which we will look at, the CARES Act audit. And that'll probably be next week, perhaps the earliest we have it, to give the audit committee a chance to become familiar with that. So that's completely optional on our part. We wouldn't be coming back to the board. I guess I would say that's probably kind of a study session more than anything else. So we will take a look at that audit. And any further estimate of when that may happen? No urgency, but are we still thinking next week, maybe?
So we have the draft of the report. It's a very brief report, but absolutely we'll be sending that. I'm going to try and send that to Sarah and Ken tomorrow. A few more edits had to be made on that today. And then I think you had suggested maybe the week. I'd suggested maybe the week after we could. I know you had thrown out some dates, Bill, to just have a call to kind of review the. You'll be underwhelmed when you see the report. It's nothing.
Oh,
like
I'm sure.
It's nothing like this report, it is a report.
It is a report, and since it's about the monies received from the federal government, we can have some due diligence, even though it's not required for official review.
Exactly.
So that's the only comments I have for the motion.
Any other comments? So we need to vote about approving this audit. Those in favor?
Aye.
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 Anybody opposed? Did I hear four ayes?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
You have to give your own aye. You only heard the other three.
I said aye. I just didn't think I heard Michael. But that's all right. Maybe he and I spoke at the same time. Okay, Bill, it's still you, Finance Committee.
All right. Hey, Bill and Liz will jump off then.
Oh, thanks very much.
Yeah, thank you guys, Bill. Everybody, thank you very for the much. Time.
Thanks, Liz.
And
thanks,
we will Bill. Talk to you soon.
Thank you. Have a good night. Bye.
Okay. This is actually just an inform item. Didn't get into any detail. This report more is on what the Finance Committee has done, rather than talking about the finances as such, which are spoken of with the monthly report. So this is just kind of a quick summary of what the committee has done for the last quarter. I think pretty straightforward. I guess I would draw your attention, the board's attention, to the second page. Two things that we did just to be of assistance or as a resource to the CEO and the board, the first being that as the recruitment was beginning, or before it began, we thought we'd ask the Finance Committee members to give their insights or opinions on what would be the qualities or attributes that we'd like to see in a new CFO. So that was done on an individual basis, and there was nothing written up about it, no summary arrived at or consensus. It was just an individual commentary by the committee members, which we hope might have been useful to our CEO as he began the recruitment. And he may have a comment. John, did you want to say something about the status of that recruitment?
Sure, absolutely. And that it was great perspective from various members. We are right in the middle of that recruitment. We've received quite a few applications. And given that the position is housed at UCSF, the UCSF recruitment team has been going through it. We've met several times to review their progress. And we recently formed the panel that will do the initial interviews, which consists of hospital staff, as well as board and finance committee staff or members.
All right. Then the second item here that the committee engaged in really as a discussion was something was submitted by Carl Gerlach, kind of a model of how much incremental revenues would be needed and assuming certain margins in any new service lines. So he worked up something and we looked at it and talked it over. And it was, it was kind of just food for thought. And no further action was planned on it. But I think we want to demonstrate again our willingness to, push some numbers around for the CEO and for the board in incremental revenues that we need to think about. So again, just a discussion. That's all I have.
Great, thank you.
Questions? Yeah.
Thank you. The next item is this parcel tax resolution. I've been informed by Jenny that this is not information, this is action. And I'm not going to take a lot of time on this. It's something that was developed. This is going to be from Josh Reimer, our chair. And it's basically a resolution from the board thanking the parcel tax campaign committee and volunteers. There are about 15 whereases here, and I'm not going to, I think if you, yeah, there they are right there. Just to highlight some of the, Steve Page, Bill Borum at co-chair, Donna Halo, people at Muehlrath Public Affairs, Gary Edwards, John Gurney, Denise Silver, Karen Collins. These are all very active people on the committee. Bob Gardner, Bill Hutchinson, Claudia Mendoza Carruth, Wendy Peterson, Dave Peer, Buddy Pep, Peter and Lori Hohorst, and then our community's physicians and hospital staff volunteering, generous members of the community donated, helped the committee raise $120,000 to finance this really wonderful campaign. Lots of volunteers. So this has been the most thorough and effective campaign effort in support of a parcel tax in the history of the healthcare district. So now it's resolved that the district board of directors thank all of the parcel tax committee members and all of the volunteers for their efforts to win the support of Measure F during the November 2021 election. And as I said earlier, I think everybody really deserves our congratulations, our warm congratulations. So we're supposed to have a roll call.
Yeah.
I wanted to, without making it the formality of an amendment, if I might suggest one other whereas, because our chair has been so modest as to leave his name off this list. So I'm going to read something here and I can, certainly anyone wants to edit it or Jenny can edit it or something, but if I may read something here and that could be put in there maybe after my name as the co-chair. So I'd like to put in there, whereas we recognize Board Chair Joshua Reimer for his foresight and leadership in advocating an early vote, parentheses, general elect, November general election, for the parcel tax, and for his dedicated participation throughout the campaign, participating in all phases of activity. So I want to be sure his name was included.
That sounds fine to me.
As he's the author of this, does he have to approve it going in there?
I mean, that's what I was thinking. It's so awkward.
So I don't know if he will or not.
No, well, we're the approvers. Mm-hmm. We're the deciders.
Yeah, so we're just going to make it
do anything we want
about himself. That's fine.
Okay.
It's a roll call vote. So Director Bjørndal, how do you vote?
Judith, I think we need to have a resolution number. And it's no one on, there's not one on here.
There isn't one on there. That is true.
What we could do is we could just amend it to say the next resolution number to be assigned.
Okay, we can do that.
I think somebody sent that to you, Jenny. I thought it was.
Yeah, we had it. It was just sent at the very last minute, so it didn't get on there.
So with that,
do you want to vote for it or bring this?
No, you can vote for it just with the understanding that it's the next resolution number to be assigned.
Okay, understood. Okay, so Director Bjørndal, how do you vote?
Aye.
Director Borum, how do you vote?
Aye.
Director Kornblatt Idel, how do you vote?
Aye.
Director Minardi, how do you vote?
Aye.
Perfect, thank you.
Okay, any board comments? What do you say we adjourn?
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.